Well, hello and welcome to this edition of the EV Revolution Show. My name is Kenneth Bocor, your host for episode 93. As we start coming out of lockdown a little bit in a lot of places here in Ontario, we're moving into stage twos, as they call it. So hopefully be able to get out and about a bit more, maybe get into another car review this summer. Who knows? We'll have to wait and see. But I hope everybody's staying safe. And thanks for joining me, taking your time out of your day to listen to me for a few minutes talk about these stories. Now, first, just a quick update on the plug-in sales market, as I tend to try to track it globally. I did receive some Canadian numbers, and you know, you heard from the last show or a couple of shows ago when I talked about the first quarter and how things were tracking. They were looking okay relative to the internal combustion vehicle market or the market as a whole. Well, as we expected, April has taken a tumble, and that's to be expected for this case. In Canada, actually, sales were down 622%. It's no surprise. Globally, the marketplaces are also declining. In April, the total number was 110,000 units. Tesla Model 3, of course, led the way with just over 11,000, almost 12,000 units. But as you can see, you know, 110,000 for a month isn't a lot if you're tracking at 2.2 or 2.3 million from the previous year. And the global global auto sales, it was at 3.8 million, so it's down 47.5% for April. Now, I'm just going to get onto the prediction horse for a sec and just repeat kind of what I said on a previous show. I predict that the market will reach for plug-in global sales for 2020 calendar year somewhere in the area of 1.5 to 1.7 million units. I sincerely hope it's a lot more, but the reality is I think that that's where it'll be. Down from 2.2 million from 2019, and that would be a 30 to 23% drop a year over year, depending on how that finishes up. So let's say 25 to 30%. The global auto sales in general is predicted to be about 74 million, which would be down about 17.6% from calendar year 2019. So if that all comes true, that means then that the plug-in vehicle market will be down more than the global, than the auto sales, the ICE V market combined, percentage-wise, that it would be down at a higher percentage. The reason I think that the plug-in market's going to be hit a bit harder is really basic math. EVs cost more. No, you know, with incentives and all this other stuff that's out there, they still cost more than a comparable internal combustion vehicle. And yes, I'm going to get people comment that, well, you save money on fuel and total cost of ownership is a lot lower and maintenance. Yes, I totally get it. I drive an EV. I preach it all the time. I get it, folks. You don't have to tell me that. But the simple fact is that in today's economy, with the risk that's there, the uncertainty, the fear, uncertainty, doubt, right, FUD that we're all seeing and experiencing and hearing, some is greater than others, the average consumer is going to think a lot more for a large purchase like a vehicle. And they are going to look at the upfront purchase price as their main motivator. If somebody needs to get a car, why wouldn't they buy a $17,000 to $20,000 Canadian Toyota Corolla? Because that's what you can drive them brand new off the lot for, versus a $45,000 Nissan Leaf. And I'm just picking on Nissan because I know their pricing. If somebody is just looking at transportation needs, that's going to come into play in a general sense. I'm just speaking generally, folks. I'm not focusing on one region. I'm just generalizing my statements that people are going to look at the upfront purchase price. So that's why I think EVs are going to be down, because we have not hit cost parity and they will be down more than internal combustions this year. That's how I believe. So take it or leave it. Put, you know, comments. Let me know what you think. It's not all bad news. The EV market will continue, and I'll keep following it. Now, let me change gears and talk about some news that's going to help continue to stimulate the EV market, even though it will be down this year. We have a future to look forward to, folks. We are going to come out of this stronger and better. So here's an example where France is now implementing more incentives and more reasons for organizations and consumers to buy EVs. French President Emmanuel Macron has announced a massive increase in support for the French car industry. As I just said, the car industry as a whole is taking a tumble. Of course, with the coronavirus slump in sales, they want to put an aid package to help the French car industry. And that aid package is coming in at more than 8 billion euros. A lot of that is put towards clean cars on the roads within 5 years. That's what they're stating. And that France wants to become one of the top producers of these vehicles in Europe. So they want to bring businesses back to France, consolidate organizations to keep manufacturing and production, the companies and factories in France as much as possible. So including these subsidies for electric cars, and they want to increase charging infrastructure to help support that. So if you're looking to buy an EV in France, you can get the subsidy increase has been up to 7,000 euros if the list price is 45,000 euros or lower. If you're a commercial organization looking to purchase electric cars, the premium rises from 3,000 euros to 5,000 euros for the incentive. Of course, it's got to be something under 45,000 euros as a list price. If you're looking at an electric vehicle that costs between 45,000 and 60,000 euros, then the incentive is 3,000 euros. And if it's over 60,000 euros, then there's no incentive at all. So good to see France doing this. And I think that this is going to be replicated by many more countries as they take a hard look at, you know, cleaning up their environments. And other governments that are looking to do that? Well, here's a report from Australia for the New South Wales government has decided to triple its procurement targets for new hybrid and all-electric vehicles as part of their passenger electric fleets. Last year, they set a target for 10%, which they actually blew through last year, that they would actually, you know, get to it by the end of this year, but they've already surpassed that. So they're increasing that target to 30% of adoption by 2023. So over the next 2.5 years or so, that means that they'll be purchasing about 900 new hybrid or electric vehicles each year, with about 300 of those being all electric models. Good to see things happening in Australia. We jump back across the pond to Norway. There's a couple of stories here. Norway's actually going to become home to a 32 gigawatt hour battery plant. There's a Norwegian company called Morrow Batteries, which plans to build battery cell factory for electric cars. It's going to have a total capacity, as I mentioned, of 32 gigawatt hours. The first of four planned expansion stages, each with 8 gigawatt hour, should be completed by 2024. Again, somewhere in southern Norway. That's, I think, where it's coming, and it's good to see that. Now, on the tails of that story, there's also another story of another company called Northvolt and Norwegian Aluminum. Northvolt and Norsk Hydro are announcing a partnership, a joint venture, to enable the recycling of battery material. So you've got one company that's spinning up to build battery cells and battery packs, and you have another company spinning up a company to able to recycle those when they reach the end of their life cycle, which is great. So this company is going to look at recycling battery materials and aluminum from electric vehicles in the Norwegian market. The joint venture company is actually called Hydrovolt, and it's going to set up operations in the Fredrikstad site, south of Oslo, near the Swedish border. About 9 million euros is being pumped into this factory build, and they should start operations sometime next year in 2021. Again, great to see both sides of the spectrum. I've reported on other companies that have started up and that are in operation and that are planning to start in the battery recycling game, because as we all know, that's going to become crucially more important as more EV adoption happens. Now, staying in Europe, there's been a lot of news lately about the Renault, Mitsubishi, and Nissan restructuring. There's a lot of stuff going on there right now as they look to fine-tune the companies, define their future plans and their goals, and streamline operations. How that's going to break down is in Europe, Russia, North Africa, and South America. Renault is going to be the key organization delivering and developing what they call mother vehicles. So you produce a mother platform, and then it has sister vehicles and all these other names of spin-off vehicles that come from that main platform. In China, North America, and Japan, Nissan will be the lead company producing vehicles. And in the Asian countries and Oceania, which is basically the rest, the lead will be taken by Mitsubishi. And how that relates is the development of the electric drive vehicles has been also divided according to these targeted markets. Renault will be responsible for the CMF A and B platforms for models in the A and B segments, and while Nissan will develop the larger CMF EV platform and plug-in hybrids, for the C and D segments will be developed by Mitsubishi. So that gives you a quick synopsis. There's a lot of articles and news going on about that, but I hope that helps give you an understanding of where these companies are looking to move forward. Switch gears to autos for a sec. Ford Escape plug-in. More information has come now. Of course, that market's heating up in the compact SUV market with the Toyota RAV4 Prime that's now entering the market. That's got a lot of splash over the last few months. Ford has, the new plug-in hybrid model of the Ford Escape, a very popular vehicle, especially here in Canada and the U.S. for the smaller SUV crowd. It was launched earlier in Europe under the brand the Ford Kuga, K-U-G-A, if I got that right, P-H-E-V. It might be one of the best, top-selling plug-in hybrids in North America anyway. We know the Mitsubishi Outlander right now is, but it's going to be some good competition for the Toyota RAV4 Prime. It's going to start at less than 35,000 MSRP before any additional charges and tax credits and all that stuff off of that. They estimate an EPA all-electric range of about 37 miles or just about 60 kilometers. So it's not that bad. It can certainly fit a lot of daily use cases for driving in electric-only mode, which is really optimum, which is really what I would try to talk consumers into if they had to buy a plug-in hybrid electric. Try to get something with the biggest battery so you can drive in battery-only mode for the most distance or for the longest point of your trips to help save greenhouse gases, right? Every time that engine runs, it's emitting gases. So that's what we want to do. Just for comparison, the RAV4 Prime is to go up to 42 miles or 67, almost 68 kilometers. So not a big difference. Battery pack on the Ford is 14.4 kilowatt hours, and it's installed under the seats and blah, blah, blah. So anybody who's got one of these on order or is getting one, I'd love to hear from you. Get your comments, and I'm sure we'll start seeing reviews of these things show up. There probably already are some European ones, but we'll see some North American ones soon. But again, I believe plug-in hybrids have kind of had their day. I think there's still a bit of a stopgap, and they're kind of getting more unnecessary as time moves forward, with bigger battery packs and more stable infrastructures and a lot of things happening. I would push people into all electric if I can in first conversations, but obviously I understand the need for plug-in hybrids still. A lot of people don't want to take that risk, and this gives you the assurance of being able to fuel when you need to. Quick story from Peugeot about the all-electric Traveler van. So they're going to electrify their existing Traveler van. It's got up to 9 seats, and it's also identical in construction to the Opel Zafira Life, which is out there. The e-Traveler is scheduled to launch in Europe at the end of this year. Again, times could change, so be cognizant of that. Electric motor has an output of 100 kilowatts, and the two battery choices of a 50 or 75 kilowatt hour version, giving a WLTP of up to 330 kilometers. You can figure out what that is in miles. What's important in the e-Traveler is it's going to come in two basic model versions, the Shuttle and the Combi Space version, which will be available in different lengths. The Shuttle is really aimed at more professional use, transport companies such as taxi operators, airport, hotel shuttles, all that kind of stuff is going to be more geared to that, which is great because that's a big market. And the Combi Space is intended more for consumers, for private customers such as large families or travelers or sports equipment or whatever, all kinds of uses. So you can go online, find all the specs about it, sizes, see some of the pictures here rolling. Again, glad to see more electrification in that larger vehicle space because they are still pretty popular. Now, I talked a little bit about earlier at the start of the show about the EV market and how it's going to fail, going to be down this year. And I don't want anybody to get in a glut over that because there is a lot of positive that's coming out of it. Now, one of the positives that's shining a bit of the light on the electrification landscape, of course, is what we're going through with the coronavirus and the pandemic. And there's an article that came out that basically says stuff that we already know. So people that are into the EV knows that follow me and other shows and are up to date kind of know that what we're seeing right now with the shutdowns and the lockdowns and the lack of oil demand because cars are sitting idle for most of the time, there's somebody that the Suncor CEO warns that this is a disruption is coming in the not so distant future to the oil market because of electrification. So linking coronavirus, what we're seeing now, to what it would be like if we had more electric cars. Well, of course, we already know that. We already know if you're taking more oil cars off the road, it's going to be better for the planet. It's going to be better for everybody. And of course, the oil demands are going to be less because there's going to be less vehicles needing oil and gas, as an example. So This CEO talked about, you know, the shifting from electric to lower carbon technologies could disrupt oil demand, similar to what we're seeing on the corona pandemic. Well, that I'm just laughing at this article because, I mean, these guys are making it all doom and gloom for the oil industry. Well, yeah, I mean, there has to be an end to the oil industry. It's decades away. I mean, the true end to the oil industry is decades away, because it's not only automotive. There's plastics and there's all these products that petroleum is used that are it's based for. So it ain't going away anytime soon, folks. However, we need to start. We need to chip away, and we need to increase the rate at what we're chipping it away to help save our planet, right? That's basically where it comes from. So, you know, they're playing this article that it's a stark prediction of an industry that downplays the impact of electrification and blah, 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 pipelines. And so, I don't know. You know, listen, you oil guys out there, you've got to see this coming. And, you know, I just keep saying, I do get people, you know, we have Alberta, we have provinces that are heavy in the oil and gas industry. And I say, look, you know, it's not going away anytime soon, but you've got to shift. You've got to shift your technologies, your resources, your jobs, your training, your knowledge base. You've got to shift it away from pipelines and oil rigs and that kind of stuff into clean technologies, solar, wind, hydro, electrification. You've got to shift it away from that. There are going to be new jobs and new requirements in those industries that are going to be needed. And these provinces and countries and areas that don't do that are going to fall behind and are going to feel the pain, similar to what they're feeling now with the pandemic. So no surprises on this article. And, you know, I just hope it kind of resonates a little bit with you folks and when you're out talking to people. Finally, final story is a neat one. Well, here's the world's largest commercial electric airplane now that has been flown for 30 minutes that can go 100 miles from a company called, it's a startup company called MagniX, supplied the motor, while Aerotech is the aerospace engineering and certification. So they modified a Cessna Caravan, which normally seats 9 people. These are Seattle-based companies. They ripped out pretty well most of the seats. They filled it in with 2 tons of lithium-ion batteries and cooling equipment, leaving very little room for passengers. Certainly, it'd be hard to get my bulk in there. They flew this plane it's got a range of 100 miles, so it's very limited, but it was really more of a proof of concept that it can be done. But it basically proved that a plane of this size could be powered solely by an electric motor. Now, the International Council on Clean Transportation has stated that commercial aviation accounts for only 2%, folks. I know I get a lot of comments and emails about, well, airplanes suck, and every time you take an airplane, you're polluting. Well, it's only 2%, though, of the global carbon emissions that commercial aviation accounts for. So it's not really a lot on the grand scheme of things, as well as 12% of the transportation sector. So it's a significant amount, but still automobiles and trucks are the largest contributors. Never mind trains and ships and all the other stuff that's out there, construction equipment, whatever. They are the biggest. But good to see that this plane flew successfully, and I'm sure we'll see this industry into a rapid development mode over the next decade. All right, and that's it for this edition of the EV Revolution Show. Oh, there's a lot of stuff to talk about today, more than I thought, actually. Thanks for sticking with me as I try to educate minds one tailpipe at a time, which is my motto. Again, hope everybody's staying safe. Now, thank you for YouTube for subscribing, liking, and commenting. It's very important, so continue to do that. If you haven't subscribed, please do. It means a lot to me. Appreciate that. Always, humble thanks to my Patreon supporters. You know who you are. Every show, I put the names of everybody coming up in the closing credits. Please stay tuned, see your name. If you don't see your name on there and you're a supporter, contact me, email me, put it in the comments, because then I'll fix it. I try to stay on top of that stuff, but it's very important, and I'm always greatly humbled and appreciative for support for Patreon. Thank you very much, especially during these times. I get it, folks. I quite understand. So thank you for that. Thank you again. Please, everybody, stay safe. Follow those social distancing. Even though we're coming out of lockdowns and we're getting into more open, some areas more than others, there's still going to be common sense, right? Keep your social distancing where you can. Wear a mask if you go out in public, okay? That's the new norm, you know? Remember back in the 70s and 80s when we saw, you know, foam dice, fuzzy dice hanging from the windshield, and then maybe in the 70s and 80s it turned into sunglasses or whatever or something neat. Well, now we're seeing masks aim from rear view mirrors. That's what I'm trying to say, not windshield. And I just noticed that the other day. I'm driving around, I see cars, I'm just looking, oh yeah, stopped, yeah, got a mask hanging. That's the new norm, folks. Nothing to be shy or ashamed about. Your safety is first, yours and other people's. So please follow safety guidelines. And I believe that's it. I hope everybody stays safe. Thank you very much for watching. Get out and enjoy the weather. Stay healthy if you can. And until the next show, I'll see you when I see you. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.